That old devil moon.
And welcome back to Let's Play Star Trek 25th Anniversary.
Message from Starfleet, sir.
Blind. On screen, Lieutenant.
The Enterprise will proceed to the Alpha Proxima system. While the indigenous race on Proxima 3 has not reached a technological level commensurate with entering the Federation, and therefore under the protection of the Prime Directive of non-interference, we do maintain a discrete monitoring satellite. It has picked up activity from an asteroid in an elliptical orbit. You are to investigate without interfering with life on the planet.
According to the library computer, the Alpha Proxima system has five planets and an asteroid belt. A large asteroid is heading towards the inner planets and should pass close by Proxima 3. It passes through the interior of the system once every 200 years. The people of Proxima 3 call it Scythe, the same name as their god of war.
God of war, Mr. Spock? Isn't that a bit surprising from a people whose technology matches 20th century Earth?
Considering the level of warfare during that century, I'm surprised that it is Earth that did not have a god of war. In any case, about a millennium ago, Proxima 3 suffered a globally devastating war.
Blew themselves back to the Stone Age, Mr. Spock?
Late Bronze Age, Ensign. They rebuilt their world in half the time it had taken to get there originally. But the Armageddon was mythologized as a battle between the Sofs and Lucas. In that war, the planet was razed, and all the gods died except Scythe. He had rained fury down upon the world, then went off on a long dance of victory. His return is a time for worldwide soul-searching and atonement.
And Scythe returns, and our monitoring station picks up activity.
It would seem that we should proceed to Alpha Proxima and scan Scythe.
Indeed. Let's see what our computer has to say. Huh?
Nothing to report at this time, Captain.
Right. Alpha Proxima.
Alpha Proxima. Star system with five planets. Alpha Proxima 3. Proxtre. And Alpha Proxima 4. Gazel. Are both inhabited worlds.
Two inhabited worlds.
Gazel, a Class M world in the Alpha Proxima system, Alpha Proxima 4, a member of the Federation and a popular leisure world. Gazel is also a major center for galactic archaeology and has many museums.
I don't remember the name of the other one, so I'll just call it by its, I guess our name for it.
Topic not available, Captain.
Oh, really? So I have to look it up by
Alpha Proxima.
Proxtray. Stop. Proxtray.
Proxtray. The third planet in the Alpha Proxima system. This Class M planet is widely habitable, except for zones of extreme radioactivity on the southern continent. About 1,000 years ago, the two dominant political systems, the Lucres and the Sofs, engaged in a nuclear war that resulted in the deaths of three-quarters of the world's population through direct or collateral damage.
Damn.
Proxtre's current civilization is non-spacefaring and does not have contact with the Federation.
Okay, so Proxima 3 does not have contact with the Federation, but Proxima 4 does. Interesting. What about these Sofs?
Sofs, one of the two ancient races of Proxtre. They lived in a highly advanced culture that valued the community ahead of the individual, which put them in conflict with the Lucres. The Sofs used base 4 in their mathematics, and their organization was based on units of 4 to make up sets of 100.
So, valued
one of the two ancient races of Proxtre. They lived in a highly advanced culture that valued the community ahead of the individual.
Community ahead of the individual. Let me guess that the Lucres put the individual above society.
Lucres, one of the two ancient cultures of Proxtre. See Sofs. The Lucres believed that a man who made the most of his ability was a god.
Right.
Their individualism put themselves at odds with the communitarianism of the Sofs. The Lukers used base 3. Their organization was based on units of 3, making up sets of 99. The number 99 was known to have religious importance to them.
Hmm. Interesting. Well, no wonder they're at odds. I mean, we have similar cultures on our planet. We also mentioned the... I don't suppose... This is probably not in there. Bronze Age?
Topic not available, Captain.
How about Prime Directive?
Prime Directive. Starfleet General Order 1. The most important law governing Federation space exploration. The Prime Directive dictates that no Starfleet personnel will interfere with the natural development of life on a planet through direct intervention or revelation of technological information to the natives. The most serious violation of the Prime Directive was the Galahad incident.
Galahad incident. Now, you know how much of a big deal it is, the Prime Directive. I've lost track of the amount of times that it's been violated for one reason or another.
Galahad incident. The most serious violation on record of the Prime Directive with an unauthorized entry of the USS Galahad into the Civil War on Shiva Omicron Fala. The Galahad stunned an army of the Geryon faction during an attempted massacre, causing the unconscious Geryons to be themselves massacred, eventually leading to the destruction of the Geryon culture. Captain Grant was court-martialed and imprisoned for his part in this genocide.
Mm. Captain Grant?
Grant. Joshua Mulroney. Captain of the USS Galahad during its first contact with the people of Shiva Omicron 4. Captain Grant used his phasers to stun the Geryon armies during a massacre, leading to the extermination of the Geryons. Captain Grant was court-martialed for this act and became famous, stating that the Human Directive is the real Prime Directive at his court-martial. The Galahad incident is used as a test case for measuring the competency of a starship captain.
Hmm. These Geryons.
Topic not available, Captain.
Geryon. A gray-skinned race of the planet Shiva Omicron 4. Their bloody persecution of the other inhabitants of Shiva Omicron led to the Galahad incident, the most serious violation of the Prime Directive. The Geryons were exterminated shortly after the incident.
We can keep going here, can't we? Shiva Omicron.
Shiva Omicron. A star system in Federation space. Shiva Omicron 4. Has begun preliminary negotiations to join the Federation. Shiva Omicron 4 is inhabited. 60 years ago, the Galahad incident resulted in the extermination of the entire Geryon race.
Wow. Okay, what about this Scythe?
Scythe.
Scythe.
A large asteroid in an elliptical orbit in the Alpha Proxima system. Spectral analysis of its composition indicates that it has minimal atmosphere and that it was once a moon of the planet Proxtrae, hurled out of its orbit by a catastrophe. The 17th letter of the Lucre alphabet is named Psi, probably not by coincidence.
Okay. Well, thank you, computer. We have to go to Alpha Proxima. Let me just see really quick where that is. On my map and this map, it is number 11, which is here. I'm hoping for no battles. I should have saved.
We're off course, Captain.
Oh my god.
Instruments indicate that we have crossed the Klingon neutral zone.
Gonna die.
Klingon ship is arming its weapon systems and raising shields.
Damage control standing.
Message from the Klingon.
On screen, Lieutenant.
Enterprise.
Yeah.
Raising shields.
Arming weapons.
We're doomed. Uh, I don't know which one we were firing at. There's like four of them?
Aye, sir.
Sensors. Yeah, which is way back here. Oh, no, no, no. What? Alpha Proxima is 12. What? I kept heading to Shiva Omicron. I guess this picture's so damn small. Alpha Proxima should be here. Let me slow down a little.
We are out of sensor range, Captain. I suggest we orbit the asteroid.
I guess this is the asteroid? Wait. This is the asteroid?
Entering standard orbit.
Let me guess. This isn't the asteroid. It doesn't look like an asteroid. Hold on, let me get my timer going again.
A sensor scan of size reveals surface features consistent with damage left by a nuclear attack. It would seem to have been a target during Proxima's war.
Scythe rained fury down on the planet and then left on a dance of victory. A missile base, Captain?
It would seem to make sense.
Captain, I just monitored a narrow beam message from Scythe to Proxima 3. I don't have it all. I just caught a bit of the initial burst. I'm attempting a translation, but it appears to be a computer code.
Any response from the planet?
The Proxtrites will not have the equipment necessary to understand and reply to that code for another 25.6 years at their present rate of development.
Don't forget that 0.6, you know, it's very important.
Still translating, Captain. I suggest we beam down, sir. The surface is hostile, but survivable for a short time.
All right, Mr. Spock. Well, that happens. Oh, I'm just gonna get another quick save in here.
Save new game. Replace.
Shields down.
Lowering shields, Captain.
Beaming down.
Spock, come with me. Mr. Scott, you have the con. Mr. Scott?
Aye, we've had some slight problems with the transporters.
Uh-oh.
We didn't notice anything beaming down.
Just a glitch in the main transporter program. Mr.
Yeah, we have no faces.
Mr. Kyle is holding a backup and we're performing tests. The transporters will be down for about an hour.
That will still give us plenty of time, Scotty.
I know. I have the lads in engineering doing a complete overhaul of the ship's systems.
Good, Mr. Scott. I'll keep you posted. Kirk out.
Mm-hmm. All right. Nice to have, Yeah, we're getting lines from all the crew. Scotty, Sulu just said something before. Uhura, Chekov. Is that a line or two? Pretty cool.
There are many rocks here.
Yes, there are.
This is the planet Proxtray, currently 600,000 kilometers from this moon.
This is the planet Proxtray? I thought we were beaming down on an asteroid called Scythe.
This looks like a heavy-duty security door built into the side of a hill on this moon.
Okay, so this is a moon. Where the hell are we? Are we on a planet? Or an asteroid? Or a moon?
This moon has a thin but breathable atmosphere.
Okay.
This is the planet Proxtray.
Okay.
600,000 kilometers from this moon.
This moon that we're on. That's the planet? Okay. Sorry, guys.
There are many rocks here.
Indeed there are.
James T. Kirk worried about the safety of the people of Proxtray. Mr. Spock looks forward to examining the technology of this ancient culture. Dr. Leonard McCoy, knowing that they aren't likely to encounter any medical problems, is rather annoyed about being dragged yet again into the transporter. Ensign Mosher seems to be rather curious about the planet's technology.
What about Mosher? I like that even more.
He doesn't seem to...
Aside from the security door on what should be a lifeless planetoid, this place is unremarkable.
Indeed, Mr. Spock.
The atmosphere is breathable, Jim, but hardly nourishing. We should either get inside or go back to the ship.
First, I'd like to talk to the mosh pit guy.
Area secure, Captain.
Thank you. Hey, Proxtray!
I get no response.
They couldn't hear me. Now, can I venture into another area? I've seen the limits of my environment. I want to see if we can go this way before we even mess with this door. And this way. Apparently not. Oops.
This moon has a thin but breathable atmosphere. This moon has a thin but breathable atmosphere.
Unremarkable except for low-grade power emanations from the door area.
You don't say.
As expected, Captain. The source of power emanations lies beyond that door.
A power source that has lasted millennia and endured major catastrophes. That's fascinating, Mr. Spock.
Do you have Vulcan blood, Ensign?
No, sir.
Alright, let's see if we can open or knock or something.
What is it, Scotty?
There is some sort of virus in the main computer.
Our
phasers and tractor beams have been disabled, and there's no way we're getting them back in 3 hours.
Virus?
There goes our backup plan. Do what you can, Mr. Scott.
Aye, I will, Captain. I may yet have a trick or two that I can pull, but don't count on any miracles.
Isolate that virus. That's your number one priority.
That it is, Captain. We'll keep you informed. Scott out.
How the hell did we get a virus?
Built into the rock is a very large door. This heavy-duty door has taken numerous micrometeorite strikes, but still appears solid. A lens sits above the doorway, but is it mere decoration?
I was wondering that. A laser beam could come out and kill all of us. Or it might be some sort of camera.
It looks like some sort of display panel. This is a keypad that looks functional.
Anything else?
Built into the rock is a... It never ceases to amaze you how passive Spock can be, even in the presence of extraordinary wonders.
Remember, he doesn't know what awe is.
Ensign Mosher is glad to be a member of this landing party, at least for now.
At least for now.
McCoy is examining himself for cosmic radiation sickness symptoms.
Oh boy. Now remember, I've kept every red shirt alive, so... I have no intention of ruining that now.
James T. Kirk, a man with a problem. A big problem that is getting bigger.
As big as this door? More energy emanations?
The door still appears to be in operating condition. A working display panel, Captain.
A working keypad, panic, Captain.
There is power running to the keypad.
This door is huge! If they were humanoid, they could have been giants.
From what we know about the Lukers, they had an affinity for size. Their machines weren't just equipment, they were also monuments.
I can believe that.
Right, so it might not be that they are huge, but the things they're passing back and forth through the door, or that they were huge.
The origin point for the broadcast to Uhura Monitor was approximately 50 meters beyond this door.
We should stay inside as much as possible. We must try to protect ourselves from the cosmic radiation.
Okay.
Well, we won't be able to phaser any outbound missiles.
It appears that our mission has increased in importance.
Hmm.
Spock, see what you can do with that lock.
Mm-hmm. Spock will do it. They loved 99.
That did not seem to work, Captain. Perhaps we should try a number that had some significance to them. Remember, they were very superstitious.
Wasn't that something about 7?
Spock, see what you can do with that lock.
That did not seem to work.
Spock, see what you can do with that lock.
That did not seem to work, Captain.
Spock, see what you can do.
That did not seem to work, Captain. Perhaps we should try a number that had some significance.
I remember 99. That's what I remember. Can we ask her?
Your situation, Mr. Scott.
We're still looking for the virus, Captain. I even have Lieutenant Uhura looking through the computer system. I never realized the last was so good with them.
Check her record, Mr. Scott. She was in the top 10% of her class in computer systems analysis.
We'll find that virus soon, Captain, or I'm an Englishman.
Just do your best, Scotty. Kirk out.
He's a Scotsman. He voted in.
The origin point for the broadcast to Uhura Monitor was
15 meters.
Spock, see what you can do.
That did not seem to...
Spock, see what you can do with that lock.
That did not seem to work, Captain. Perhaps.
Okay, I really don't know why. I'm gonna start my timer again. I looked up a walkthrough for this. I don't know why. I'm sure it has something to do... Wait. It's 10200. Hold on, let me see something. Yeah, unless it's something else that we haven't seen. Then, I don't know. I'm just gonna use it.
Spock, see what you can do with that.
It's 10200. Maybe Spock will explain.
Ah, that worked. I see you deduced that 10200 in the Lucre's base 3 was equal to their sacred number 99.
Whatever. Not good at it. Anyway.
Report, Scotty. How are things going?
About as badly as a killed in a blast furnace, Captain.
That's bad.
Wait a minute. Lieutenant Uhura has some news for you.
The virus came from our sensor sweep of the moon's computers. We believe we have analyzed the memory sectors it attacked.
Oh. Well done, Uhura.
I wish I could take credit for it. It was Mr. Kyle who found the pattern. We are attacking it with antivirus programs.
Computer science sounds more like medicine every day.
If we had a doctor as good with computers as you are with patients, we'd be having a lot fewer problems.
Finally, someone who appreciates me.
Keep working at it, Uhura. Kirk out.
How can you catch a computer virus in outer space from scanning something? You got me.
This looks like some kind of security lock with heavy-duty doors on both ends.
Or this does?
The door has some strange writing on it.
What does it say?
James Kirk, the burden of command is quite heavy at times. Spock looks at the equipment and raises an eyebrow. McCoy wishes this place was less technological. Ensign Mosier is scanning the area for potentially hostile life forms.
Nope, don't see any. Unless they're little viruses.
A computer terminal. Each word in the Lucre language has three aspects: submissive, neutral, and aggressive, to supply connotation to their language.
That's interesting. And we, you know, in the other episode, the Feathered Serpent? No, was it the Feathered Serpent? No, the one before that. The one with Mud. Another Fine Mess. There were aliens whose base was 6. So they're really fond of that in this game, aren't they?
This looks like some kind of security lock.
What are these?
This looks like some kind.
Okay.
The door has some strange writing on it.
And a red thingy, like the other door.
The Lucres did not seem to have a problem with security.
My tricorder is picking up large supplies of frozen oxygen, nitrogen, and carbon dioxide beneath the surface. Enough to last many centuries.
At least we won't have to worry about suffocating. This place does seem to provide protection against cosmic rays.
I don't see why they bothered putting an atmosphere here, Captain. There hasn't even been bacteria here in centuries, let alone humanoids.
Well, at one point there were.
We appear to be in some type of security lock. No defensive systems are apparent here, but considering the size of the doors, they probably don't need them.
The interior of the security lock is unremarkable and well-preserved. This door is similar to the one on the outside of the secure lock, except that it has not weathered over the years. Electrical panels indicate the keypad on the right controls the door.
This one?
The interior of the
Or this?
A computer terminal, Captain. It uses the Lucre alphabet. I think I can decipher it.
Well then, go, Mr. Spock. That would be Mr. Spock.
Console reports the following.
It's like he just slapped it.
Welcome to Orbital Missile Base. Codename, Psi. This base has been operational for the past week. It has completed one successful fire mission. Estimation of success is at 22 over 100.
22%? That's very low. Hardly something to brag about.
Doctor, in Base 3, 22 divided by 100 is equivalent to 8 out of 9, or 88%.
Oh, boy.
I would think that quite satisfactory, given this base's probable mission of destroying the soft forces on Proxtree.
It says the base has been operational for a week, but this has been here for 1,000 years.
If the Lucres built this base with a clock that told the time by measuring the moon's rotational speed, or the gravitational forces generated by Proxtree and the sun, the computer may have calculated only a week of time has passed since its first action. I might be able to learn more with another look at the console. There is a substantial amount of data here, but in summary, Scythe was created by the Lucres as a launching platform for missiles to keep the Sofs subjugated to their influence. The Sofs managed to infiltrate the base. However, their actions triggered Scythe's auto-attack mechanisms and initiated a holocaust that nearly annihilated the planet. One soft strike did, in fact, hit the moon and deflected it from its orbit. It has been dormant since then.
So why has the base been activated again?
Given the damage to the moon, its slow rotation and orbit, it has never realized the war is over. On this pass, for the first time, it has detected radio wave transmissions from Proxtree. Because it does not recognize them, it assumes the Sofs are still active. Its transmission to the planet, I would assume, was some sort of a check beacon to see if it should continue its mission.
Jim, let's return to the ship and blast this place to destroy its weapons.
Doctor, this moon is a god to the people down there. If we destroy it, we will violate the Prime Directive.
Mm-hmm. Spock is right, Bones. Spock, what are the chances that we could decode the transmission and send a stop code to the base?
In trinary or decimal?
Spock!
1.327 million to 1. Provided the archaeological studies about Lucre's languages are correct, our other option is to get into this base and see if we can bring the computers down.
Yeah, those are not very good odds. Is there anything more to say?
The console reports the following. Welcome to Orbital Missile Base.
Same.
Code name. 22%?
Doctor, in base...
It says...
If the loop... There is a substantial... A soft... One soft...
So why is the base...
Given the damp... Because it doesn't... It's...
Jim, let's...
Doctor, this...
Spock is...
In trine...
Spock!
1.327...
She had a lot to say with that. That little, I wouldn't say it's a cutscene, but...
My tricorder is picking up...
At least we won't...
Open door?
He looks at you.
I certainly see nothing.
Spock, see what you can do with this.
The console reports the welcome to...
I want to open the door.
In base, if the Lucas built this, there is a soft managed one...
So why is the...
Given the damage to the... Because its transmission...
Jim, let's return to...
Doctor, this...
Spock is
right.
Spock! 1.3...
Maybe it's this? Looking for the keypad.
A keypad in base 3.
Huh.
Spock, see what you can do with that lock.
Spock, do this. Spock, do that. Now, I know I look to the next number and this is 122. I'm like, are there any more numbers?
Fascinating. If the Federation language studies were correct, the ideograph for the word scythe in the Lucre's language is the 17th symbol in their alphabet.
That I remember.
That corresponds with 122 in base 3.
There's no way, guys. This particular episode is not my forte, I would say.
You see another chamber.
Mm-hmm.
You see another chamber.
I
you see another chamber.
Yes, we do. Let's go forward.